Are invited to head on down to kids' worship, and as they head down, I invite you to open up your copy of the scripture to Mark chapter 3, and Mark chapter 3 is where we find ourselves as we continue our journey through this gospel. And as you turn there, just a bit of church business to update you on so that you can be in the know and also be praying. Many of you have been tracking with Mike Murray. He's doing really well. I was actually able to visit him whatever day it was this week. And he's doing very, very well, all things considered. I'm sure he's listening. Hello, Mike, if you are. At this point, with his health, obviously he is not able to continue chairing the elder chair for our lay elder team. And so we have appointed to take into his place Rich Feaster, who many of you will know. So be praying for Rich as he gets into the swing of things, learning how to do that new role as the chairman of our elder team. Really, that role is simply to make sure that the lay elders are doing what they're supposed to be doing, helping lead the meetings so that we're discussing the things we need to discuss, and also for him to just keep us crazy pastors in line as well, which is not an easy task. So be praying for him, and we'll let you keep you updated on also who the co-chairman will be when we select him this month. So we're in Mark chapter 3. And we're going to be looking at verses 20 to 35 this morning. Let me read God's word for us. Then he, Jesus, went home, and the crowd gathered again so that they could not even eat. And when his family heard it, they went out to seize him, for they were saying, "He is out of his mind." And the scribes who came down from Jerusalem were saying, "He is possessed by Beelzebul. And by the prince of demons, he casts out the demons." And he called them to him and said to them in parables, "How can Satan cast out Satan? If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end. But no one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house. Truly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man and whatever blasphemies they utter. But whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. For they were saying, he has an unclean spirit. And his mother and his brothers came, and standing outside, they sent to him and called him. And a crowd was sitting around him, and they said to him, "Your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you." And he answered them, "Who are my mother and my brothers?" And looking about those who sat around him, he said, "Here are my mother and my brothers, for whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother." This is God's word. We better pray. We're going to need it. Father, we do thank you for your word, and we realize that sometimes as we are studying it, we bump into texts that are difficult and require a lot of wisdom. So we pray for just that. We pray for your wisdom. We pray that our minds and hearts would be enlightened by the Holy Spirit to understand the truth that Jesus has here for us. We pray these things in his name. Amen. Here at Grace, one of our core values is the gospel, our passion. We prize the gospel. We prize the total, free, full forgiveness that God gives to any and every single person who repents and believes in the Lord Jesus for salvation. We prize truths that are contained in verses like John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Or Acts 16:31. Believe in the Lord Jesus and you will be saved. Or we could go to Colossians 2, 13 through 14. You who were dead in your trespasses, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing to the cross. Or we could look at Romans 5, 20, where sin increased, grace abounded all the more, as we just sang. Our sins were deeper than the sea, but his grace was deeper still. There is no sin that God will not forgive for those who turn to the Lord Jesus. And Jesus himself affirms this truth in verse 28 of the passage that we're looking at this morning. Take a look at verse 28. Jesus says, "Truly, I say to you, all sins will be forgiven the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter." But the challenge for us in the text this morning is the word that comes right after verse 28. He says, "But." So, all sins will be forgiven the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter, but. There is an exception clause to God's forgiveness. There is a moment where God's grace and patience wear out. There is one sin that God cannot and will not forgive. But, Jesus says, whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. We're looking this morning at the unforgivable sin. And the question that lies before us is, what is this unforgivable sin? As Don said, is a challenging text, and it's important for us to know what this sin is. If there is a sin that people, that we, even ourselves, could commit that would send us straight to hell with no hope of salvation, could condemn us where we stand, we ought to know what that sin is. This text is a challenge. It's not a straightforward text. It's not even straightforward when it's mentioned in Mark and Luke either. There's a lot of opinions about how it's to be interpreted, and there's a lot of misunderstanding on how it should be interpreted. So we want to get it right. We want to know what Jesus is saying in these verses. So we're going to walk through this text together, considering the whole thing in its context so that we can have the answer. What is this unforgivable sin, the sin that God cannot and will not forgive? And the first thing that we see in this text is, number one, verses 20 to 22, the critics claim Jesus is evil. That's what we see happen in the beginning of this text. The critics claim Jesus is evil. Take a look at verse 20. We're shocked when we look at verse 20 to discover that the critics are actually Jesus' own family. Jesus goes home, the crowd that we were talking about last week that was following him everywhere he went, they gather again, and they're so large that Jesus and his disciples can't even find space to eat. And in verse 21, his family hears about this, and they go out to seize him, Mark says, literally to grab him, to capture him. Why? Because they were saying to each other, Jesus, I think, has gone out of his mind. I think that actually maybe Jesus has gone mad. I mean, yeah, maybe he's the Son of God, but this just seems like it's getting out of hand. This seems like he's going too far. They were saying, verse 21, he is out of his mind. You know, we just got done celebrating Christmas. We think about Mary, and we think about her assurance and her faith and her steadfastness in the Christmas story when she's told that she, as a virgin, will give birth to Jesus. But even Mary herself struggled and doubted the identity of Jesus in her own journey with him. And I think there's a comfort here for Christians who come predominantly from a non-Christian family. There are some here who, your following of Jesus, your Christianity is a point of contention with your family. It causes arguments, it causes division, it causes problems. And the amazing thing about Jesus is in following him, he himself
knows that sort of grief. He himself knows that family pain, the family strife that comes from people who just, his own family, who didn't want to follow him and didn't believe in his identity. And when we pray to him, bringing that family grief to him, we're praying to someone who gets it firsthand. He can call up memories in his own heart of that grief. So the family criticizes him, but there's another group also in this text that are his critics. Take a look at verse 22. The second group are the scribes who came down from Jerusalem. Not just any ordinary scribes, but the scribes from Jerusalem, the big cheese, the head honchos. These are the ones who are working in the capital city of Israel. These are the guys who were the cream of the crop when it came to being Bible teachers. They knew the scriptures well. They were the head teachers of all the people of God. And they are coming to Jesus, and they give their opinion on just who Jesus is. What was their opinion? Now take a look at verse 22 again. The scribes who came from Jerusalem were saying, "He is possessed by Beelzebul, and by the prince of demons, he casts out the demons." Who is this Beelzebul? We hear that and that just kind of goes over our head. Well, in the Old Testament, the Philistines had a false god called Beelzebub. And his name meant the Lord of the Flies, just like the classic book, The Lord of the Flies. The Jews in Jesus' day, they changed the name around a little bit, changed it from Beelzebub to Beelzebul. And this is what that name means. It literally means the God of dung, the God of dung. So the scribes are really, really, they couldn't say anything worse about Jesus than what they're saying here. They're saying, you know where Jesus belongs? He belongs in the toilet. The best thing we can do is just flush him down and get him down to where he belongs, down with the filth of the world. That's where his kingdom resides. By the prince of demons, he casts out demons. He may even be Satan himself. He's certainly working for him. Isn't it crazy? The ones who should have known best who the Messiah would be from the scriptures are the ones who, when they meet him, mistake him for Satan. So what does Jesus do? In the next section, Jesus corrects his critics. He corrects his critics. I love what Jesus does here. If you read the Gospels, he's so masterful at answering people, his critics. He does what any wise debater would do. He uses their logic against them to show the foolishness of their statement. And he uses illustrative language. So in verse 23, he gathers these scribes together and he asks them the question, "All right, guys, let's think through this. How can Satan," he says, "cast out Satan?" And then he speaks in parables. He says in verse 24, "If a kingdom is divided against itself, that kingdom cannot stand. And if a house is divided against itself, that house will not be able to stand. A nation divided against itself is a nation that will crumble. A family that cannot get along will be a dysfunctional family, the family that will crumble itself." And then he applies it to Satan in verse 26. "And if Satan has risen up against himself and is divided, he cannot stand, but is coming to an end." Jesus is essentially saying, "Scribes, you really believe that Satan, the cunning, the crafty one, the one who really is pretty wise at what he's on about with all his works of evil, you really think that he would rise up and try to destroy himself? What would be the point of that?" And then he clarifies just what his relationship to Satan is in verse 27. Verse 27, he talks about Satan as a strong man and Satan's kingdom as a house that needs to be plundered. In verse 27, he says, "No one can enter a strong man's house and plunder his goods unless he first binds the strong man. Then indeed he may plunder his house." Jesus is making the point by figurative language, "I'm not with him. I have come actually to destroy him. I have come to bind him
That's why I'm casting all these demons out. That's why I'm pushing against the forces of darkness. I am here to put Satan in his place and to reclaim all that is mine out of his hands. I'm not with him. I'm out to destroy him. How ironic. The very one Jesus came to destroy is the very one the scribes say he is working with. It's baffling. But you know, that spirit is still alive and true in our day. People who look at Jesus and see what he does, see the works that he does, the claims that he made, and they deduce that he's not actually good for people, but he's actually bad. That he's not good, he's actually evil. I was listening to an interview by Stephen Fry recently. He's an English comedian. We used to work with Hugh Laurie in a show back in the 70s, I think. He is a renowned atheist, and in the interview, the interviewer asked him, what would you do if you died and discovered that God really does exist? What would you say? What would you do? This was Stephen Fry's reply. Stephen Fry said, I would ask God, how dare you? How dare you create a world where there is so much misery and pain that is not our fault? It's not right. It's utterly, utterly evil. Why should I respect a capricious, mean-minded, stupid God who would create a world filled with such injustice and pain? And the interviewer goes, and you think he'll let you in? Stephen Fry replies and says, no, but I don't want to go in. Not on his terms. He says, he's evil. It is obvious God is a maniac. We ought to spend our entire existence thanking him and bowing down to him? Nonsense. Isaiah 5:20 says, woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. The extent, the capacity for man to harden his heart against goodness itself, to see the beauty of God in the scripture, to gaze upon the real Jesus and say, that is evil. I don't want anything to do with that. Where does that kind of attitude end? What is the end result of that sort of spirit? That's what we see Jesus do next in verse 28 through 30. He moves from correction to caution. Jesus cautions his critics on committing the unforgivable sin. He answers in warning to them. He says in verse 28, truly I say to you, whenever you read that statement in the gospel, by the way, because Jesus says it a lot, truly, truly I say to you, that's biblical language where Jesus is essentially putting his shoulder on, or his hand on your shoulder, looking you in the eye and saying, I'm telling you something very serious right now. Absorb this. That's what Jesus is saying when he says, truly I say to you. And what does he begin with? He begins with grace. He begins with the offer of forgiveness. He tells the scribes, all sins will be forgiven, the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter. You want forgiveness, you can have forgiveness. Come to me, I'll give you forgiveness. Place your trust in me as the Savior, as Lord. I can forgive you. But, verse 29, here's the caution, here's the warning. Whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is guilty of an eternal sin. So we have to do some investigation. What is this unforgivable sin? What does it mean to blaspheme the Holy Spirit? We have to do some investigative work. And we're going to begin by clarifying, first of all, what the unforgivable sin is not. What the unforgivable sin is not. The unforgivable sin is not merely speaking against the Holy Spirit. You know, you take God's name in vain, or you use Jesus Christ as a curse word, and then, you know, somehow maybe if you say something against the Holy Spirit, then that's the unforgivable sin. You do that, whoa, then you're done. That is not what it means, and we know that because of what Jesus says in the preceding verse, in verse 28. Take a look at what Jesus says right before verse 29. All sins will be forgiven the children of man and whatever blasphemies they utter. So all vocal sins, if you will, even the worst of things that you could say about God, Jesus says even those blasphemies, they can be forgiven. So it's not something that we say. This blasphemy is of a different nature. And we're clued in to what Jesus is talking about in verse 30. In verse 30, Mark clarifies in verse 30 that Jesus said this because, he says, for they were saying, he has an unclean spirit. So you see the contrast. Jesus is talking about the Holy Spirit, and they are claiming he has an unclean spirit. So we have to understand what's at work here in the text. The key to identifying the unforgivable sin is to understand the relationship between the Holy Spirit and Jesus, the person of the Spirit and the person of the Son, Jesus Christ. What is the role of the Spirit when it comes to Jesus? We're told in Isaiah 11:2 in a prophecy how the Holy Spirit would work with the Messiah when he comes, what the Spirit's relationship to Jesus would be when he came. And we're told, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. The Spirit would be actively at work, empowering Jesus, enabling him, sustaining him throughout his earthly ministry. And what did we see in the beginning of Mark when Jesus is baptized? What happened? The Spirit descended upon him, showing indeed that the power of God was at work in him as God himself. You look at Jesus, you see Jesus at work. What you are seeing is not the power of Satan, but the power of God through the Holy Spirit. And what's the Spirit's role in drawing men and women to Jesus? Jesus tells us in John 16, verse 8 and 14, speaking of the Spirit, he says, when the Spirit comes, he will convict the world concerning sin and righteousness and judgment. He will glorify me, Jesus says. The role of the Holy Spirit is to convict men and women who are unbelievers of their sin, to help them feel the guilt of the condemnation in which they stand before God in their sin, and to show them their need of a Savior. And then Jesus says, he will glorify me. It's like the Spirit puts the spotlight on Jesus and says, and here is the one who can save you. Here is the one in whom you need to trust. This is the one in whom salvation is found. Come to him. That's what the Holy Spirit's role is, to convict us and to point us to Jesus. So what happens when you harden your heart to the Spirit's work of convicting you of your sin, showing you the need that you have for a Savior, and pointing you to Jesus? What happens when you say, I don't want anything to do with him? I don't want that. And you keep grieving his work at drawing you to Christ. You remain in unbelief. Putting all of it together then, what is the unforgivable sin? The unforgivable sin is to live and die in willful opposition to the truth of the gospel. It's to hear the gospel message, to feel the Spirit's conviction, to feel the very truth that you do need Jesus, and just to say no. To look at Jesus and to say, that's not good for people, it's bad for people. I don't want anything to do with that. J.C. Ryle is helpful when he writes about the unforgivable sin. He says, the unforgivable sin is a combination of clear intellectual knowledge of the gospel with deliberate rejection of it and willful choice of sin. Cranfield, in his commentary, he warns about what sort of people are the ones who are most apt to commit this unforgivable sin. He says in his commentary, this warning is particularly to those who have grown up in the church and may even have some theological education, but have willfully rejected it and in their heart of hearts attribute supposed Christian reality to evil. I sit on the board of a local ministry here, and the founding of its ministry is a denomination that is currently dividing over the issue of homosexuality. And really, it's a bigger picture. They're dividing over way more, but that's the big button. And everyone on this board are Bible-believing Christians, and one in particular knows exactly really what's going on in this denomination. And he said, there are literally no pastors in this denomination who are in the pipeline to go into these churches, none of them that are Bible-believing, that believe that the Scripture is inerrant, none who stand on the exclusivity of Christ alone, that salvation is only through him. And all of the training systems for this denomination are thoroughly theological liberal. They have nothing. And they would say, well, you know, we have scriptural interpretation differences. No, you don't. You have hardness of heart problems. You have unbelief in the real Jesus issues. You're rejecting the goodness of Jesus as it stands in the Scripture and saying, no, I think we need to rewrite the Scripture because some of the stuff in here isn't good for people. And actually, we've become more enlightened in our age, and we need to get away from that stuff and rewrite the truth for God because I think he got it wrong in some places. We have whole churches that are going to send multitudes of people to hell in our nation and around the world. Do we take seriously the warning that Jesus has here for those who do not believe in Christ alone for salvation? Does it upset us as believers that there are multitudes who, if they die today in their hardness of heart, they'll go to hell? Do you understand what hell is? Hell is the complete absence of everything lovely, everything enjoyable, everything good and pleasurable, and it is the complete presence of everything that is awful and tormenting, physically painful, emotionally agonizing, without God, and forever. It never ends, and people are really going to go there. Do we feel the urgency to plead with people, persuade people, our friends, our family? Some of you are in the retirement community. Think about the next time you're in that dining hall and you look around at all those beautiful people. They're well-dressed. They're sitting around at the dining table. They're having the time of their lives, eating their meals, smiling, laughing, and yet they stand condemned. Who's going to tell them the truth? Who is going to persuade them? Will we be the ones? Well, there may be some here this morning who the question in your heart is, could I commit this sin? Those of you who are trusting in Christ and you think to yourself, can Christians commit this unforgivable sin? And surely Jesus, in verses 31 through 35, Jesus comforts believers with the certainty of their salvation. For genuine, true Christians, those who are trusting in Christ, verse 28 is what applies to us. All sins will be forgiven, the children of man, and whatever blasphemies they utter. I love that this passage comes right after Jesus talks about this unforgivable sin. In verse 31, his brothers, his mother come, and they're standing outside, and they want to talk to him, but they can't get through to the crowd. So the crowd says in verse 32, hey, your folks are outside, they want to talk to you. And Jesus, being a little creative, being a little facetious, don't use big words if you can't say them, Adam, says in verse 33, he answered them, and he looks at the crowd, he says, who are my mother and my brothers? And looking about at those who sat around him, he said, here are my mother and my brothers, whoever does the will of God. It's one of the biggest heartbreaks for me as a pastor to see Christians who struggle with assurance. It really is heartbreaking. There are some Christians who just, their entire faith journey, they really doubt the love of God. They doubt that Jesus really has done all that that is necessary for God to accept them and to love them and to call them friend. And I love that Jesus here, the relationship that he describes he has with his people is a familial relationship. When Jesus looks at true believers, he doesn't just see, you know, oh, they're my clients, or they're my underlings, or they're my servants. He looks at us and he says, they're my family. They're my brother. They're my sister. I'll never let them go. They're mine forever. And then he clarifies just who are the true Christians who can be assured, you belong to me. In verse 35, he says, whoever does the will of God, he is my brother and sister and mother. Unlike those like the scribes who have hardened their heart, true believers are those who have not just heard the gospel, but have responded to the gospel, believed the gospel, and now spend their whole lives submitted to Jesus in great joy. And it's the joy of their lives to serve him, to give them their all, to give him their all. Jesus doesn't demand perfection, but he does expect love and a desire to grow in our obedience. Some of us here this morning, I know I can think this myself, we stand and we think, well, have I done enough? You know, am I growing enough? Is, you know, that desire to do the will of God, is it there? Am I accepted? I love what Calvin says for those who sometimes are discouraged about their own walk with the Lord. He said, let us not despair because of our slender measure of success in the faith. Our labor is not lost when today is better than yesterday, provided we keep our aim, aspire to the goal, and make it our constant endeavor to become better Christians. Who are my mother and my brother? Jesus says, whoever does the will of God, whoever believes, whoever obeys. Well, what do we do to apply this text, this challenging text? I think we go to John 3:18. That strikes the perfect balance for us. Whoever believes in him is not condemned. You believe in Jesus. You're trusting in him actively for your salvation. Be assured, he has you. But whoever does not believe is condemned already. Hardened in your heart, opposed to the gospel, you stand condemned in your sin because Jesus says he's not believed in the name of the only Son of God. Belief in Christ is the assurance that we are his, and unbelief in him assuredly condemns us and sends us to hell. The question for us is, when it comes to Jesus, are you in or are you out? Are you his or are you opposed? That's the question that matters most. Next week, when we take a look at chapter 4, we're finally going to get into chapter 4, Jesus is going to begin the parables. And he is going to tell us next week that there are many responses that we can have to him. But there's only one response that is genuine. Faith and obedience. Let's pray. Father, we pray that whatever the Holy Spirit is convicting us this morning, we would not harden our hearts. We pray that he would help us more and more to understand this text, to obey this text, so that we might walk in obedience to Jesus and belong to him. We pray in Jesus' name.